Hey, yo, check it.
What's good, y'all? Thank you for tuning in to the first episode of the Danny Digital Show. Some of you may know me as Danny Digital, Dizza, D-Lover, Oreo, or O. However you may know me, this is my show. And I'd like to welcome and introduce our first ever guest on the show, Jared Ogungbemi-Jackson. Jared Ogungbemi-Jackson is a Canadian-Jamaican professional basketball player from Winnipeg, Manitoba. Jared Ogungbemi-Jackson is an alumni of College Garden City Collegiate. During his time there, he was named a two-time back-to-back Player of the Year, two-time back-to-back Provincial Finals MVP, and won back-to-back Provincial Championships in 2008 and 2009. Jared now presents his own scholarship to a worthy student-athlete at College Garden City Collegiate who shows a relentless level of work ethic and commitment to basketball and also maintains a level of enthusiasm and positivity that is indispensable to their team. After his days at Garden City, he would then move on to play university basketball at the University of Calgary from 2009 till 2015. During his time there, Jared was named a CanWest Second Team All-Star once, a CanWest First Team All-Star twice, and Jared finished his career at the University of Calgary first in all-time minutes played, first all-time in steals, and as a third all-time scorer at the University of Calgary. After his university basketball career was done, he would then decide to turn pro. Jared would go on to play professional basketball in over five countries, such as Portugal, Spain, France, Finland, and Netherlands. In 2020, Jared had the opportunity to compete in the FIBA World Cup, where he would go on to average 24 points per game in the two games he played in. Last season, while playing for the Bakken Bears, Jared won the Danish Championship, was named a FIBA Cup All-Star, and a Danish League All-Star. Just recently, he signed a contract to return to France and play for Orléans Loiret Basket. Jared is a positive influence and role model in the community, and I am grateful to have him as a mentor, and even more grateful to be a part of the community that he built. His motto is to stay true and be great. So yeah, man, thank you, Jared, for coming on the show and making time for this, and congratulations on the new contract.
Thanks, man. I'm happy to be here and happy to help you kick off, you know, your first episode for your podcast, and hopefully we can have a great conversation.
Great. Yeah, I'm looking forward to that too. So the first question I wanted to kind of talk about, or topic I wanted to talk about, is that I know you've been around the world getting to play basketball in many countries. What are some of the lessons or life skills you've learned along the journey?
The biggest life skills I've learned, you know, my professional career thus far, I would just say is, you know, accepting different cultures and accepting different people and countries and ways of life. You know, like I've, like you said, I've been around the world. I've seen, you know, Scandinavian countries. I've seen Western European countries. And, you know, there's different cultures. There's different ways to eat. There's different ways to talk. People speak different languages. Yeah. There's different religions. There's different beliefs. So I think that's just the biggest thing for me is, you know, obviously growing up in a smaller town, you know, or, you know, in Canada, if you don't get the chance to travel as much, you may only see and believe what you see. So I think for me, the biggest thing is just, you know, having that opportunity to see how people live, see how people talk in different countries and different cultures and embrace that and not judge people because everything is different. We live a certain way and people in different countries live a certain way. Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, so the next question I wanted to ask is, was it hard for you to leave home, to be away from home and play basketball at the University of Calgary? And was it hard to kind of mature and grow up on the spot?
For me, it wasn't challenging just because, like, you know, it was always my goal to become a professional. Mm-hmm. And, you know, from a young age, you know, 12, 13, you know, I always wanted to become pro. Mm-hmm. And once the opportunity for me to go to University of Calgary, you know, became a real thing, I just said, you know, I'm going to use this as a platform for me to become a pro. This is going to be my trial and error as far as being away from home, being away from my family for the first time. So mentally, I was strong enough to go in knowing that there's going to be ups and downs.
Yeah.
But I was using it to prepare me to become a professional. So for me, it wasn't necessarily a challenging process.
Great. And now we're talking about goals and goal setting and all that. The next question I want to ask is, why is it important to manifest your dreams and goals? Because I know with you, like, manifesting it was putting sticky notes all over your house and telling yourself you're able to do it or you could achieve this. Why is it important to do that?
Man, I think that's something that you have to learn over time. And it just shows how bad you want something. You know, I feel like talk is cheap.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like, you know, a lot of people will say things, but do they put forth, you know, the effort and the dedication and the time to actually achieve what they want to achieve? So, you know, at a young age, you know, I had goals of mine. I wanted to be the best player, you know, in Winnipeg, you know, in my grade 11 year, my grade 12 year. I wanted to become a professional. So I was just like, if I want this thing so bad, why not write this down? Like, let me just write this down, you know, and I can go back to it every 2 weeks or every month or every 3 months. I still do it to this day. I journal about negative things that happen in my life.
Yeah.
I journal about positive things. I journal about what I want to see for the next 6 months or for this year or for this. I don't do New Year's resolutions. I do monthly every other month. And for me, it's a way to go back and check and be like, okay, I said I wanted to do this.
Yeah.
Am I putting forth the work now to become this? And if I'm not, then I can hold myself accountable that way, opposed to just saying something in the air one time and you're just leaving it there, you know? So I feel like the more you see something, the more you read it, the more you see it every day, the more you speak it with your mouth, it's like you're manifesting that into your life in some fashion.
Yeah.
So I really, really believe in
that. Yeah, I feel that. Like I do, not to my own horn, but like I do a lot of journaling and, you know, positive aspects, you know, good things in your life, bad things. But one thing for me that I found that works is I have my own whiteboard in my room and it's kind of like a list of goals and achievements and everything I want done by my senior year.
Mm-hmm.
And that's right beside my bed. So right when I wake up, that's the first thing I see. So it's definitely like when you see that every day, it's like, and you put in the work, it's bound to happen.
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
The next question I want to ask is, what did it take for you to do in order to be where you're at?
Oh, that's a fully loaded question. Obviously, it took a lot of work, you know, it took a lot of sacrifice. And I know those are the words that people, you know, say, you know, you got to work hard, you got to sacrifice. But, you know, if we could go read the full definitions of those words, I would think that would be a reflection of what I did. You know, like when I was younger, you know, I was always in the gym. I was always working out. I was always watching basketball. You know, I was like addicted, like it was almost as if it's a drug, you know, like.
Yeah.
You know, I was always the first in the gym. I was always the last one. You know, I was waking up early before school in the snow, in minus 35 weather with the basketball in my hand, waiting for the bus for 25 minutes.
And then getting there. I'm sure we're
getting to school, you know, like your hands are frozen and I'll go and work out for an hour and a half before school starts.
Yeah.
And like, I'm not talking like just shooting around. I'm sprinting. I'm doing suicides. I'm going full court with the ball, you know, and obviously you have to have some skill and talent.
Yeah.
But I feel like that was the basis of how I got to where I was okay, the work, like I'm going to make sure that I outwork everyone. That was my goal at a young age. It was like, I have to outwork everyone. Now I'm at a stage where I only focus on myself. I only try to compete with myself. I don't try to compete with other people. And then the other, you couple that with obviously having a good foundation, you know, having good friends, having a good circle of people around you, positive influences, you know, family is important. Coaching is important. So those things, you know, are very key. You know, you have to keep a good circle around you, the people around you. They say that, you know, the three people that you're closest to is how your life is going to end up, you know? So I would say those two things is what helped me to get to this, this stage today.
And for anyone that doesn't know, like Jared's work ethic is legendary. I remember coach Phil Penner talking about in an athletic banquet speech, talking about if Jared would miss two shots, he would make himself run and go super intense, like, talking like 200% intensity, whole practice, and then doing that on top of that. So that's how legendary his work ethic is. The next question I wanted to ask was, describe your work ethic in high school. Like, I know we were just talking about that, but describe your work ethic in high school, and does it surprise you where you're at now?
Like I said, you know, in the high school for me, it was... like, obviously, I had a lot of work with Phil Penner and other coaches and other players. It's not just myself. Of course, I had help with others. But like I said, you know, in the early mornings, I was there, you know, before school started, sometimes after school, and then we would have practice. So my work ethic in high school was just like making sure that I outworked everybody. That was my goal, was like, I'm going to outwork everybody in this province. That was my goal.
Yeah.
Because I felt like, you know, if I do that, I'll be one of the best, or if not the best in the province, you know? So that was my work ethic there. And did you say, what was the second part of the question?
It said, does it surprise you where you're at now?
No.
Yeah.
Like, I don't say that cockily, like to be cocky, but you know, I put in so much work. I envisioned this, you know, I did as much, I believe I did everything I could to put myself in this position, obviously with the help of others, my family, my parents, the coaches I've had, things of that nature. But I feel like I did all the work that I did to be here. You know, let's just be real. We're not in LA. We're not in New York. We're not, you know, I'm not from Toronto or, you know, some of the more prestigious basketball cities, yeah. You know, and this is in a time where there was no social media, there wasn't personal trainers,
there wasn't even like club basketball,
YouTubes and all. Like there was YouTube, but it was, you know, towards the tail end of my high school career, so there wasn't mixtapes, you know, I didn't have any high school mixtapes or things like that, so it was a lot harder, you know, and I'm a 5'10 guard at the end of the day, so I had to put forth a ton of effort, you know, ton of work to get to where I am today. Obviously some things fell into place with the connections I've had, but I believe I'm where I'm supposed to be.
Okay. And the next question was, how important was it for you to have a good support system at home and at school when you were growing up?
Yeah, that's the biggest thing. Like I said, you know, you can work hard as hard as you want, but if you don't have the right people around you, if you have bad influences, if you have friends who are doing things that they shouldn't be doing, and you're following them, you know, you're going to derail from your path.
Exactly.
And, you know, same thing in the household. If you have a foundation where, you know, your parents or your sisters or siblings, if you have, if they support you, it helps.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I know that that's, you know, I talk about all my hard work and all my individual work, but my parents, my brothers, my, you know, my sisters, my aunts, my uncles, my cousins, you know, they were at my games supporting me. They were encouraging me to play, encouraging me to play different sports, you know, encouraging me to, oh, you know, you had a bad game, but tomorrow's going to be better.
Yeah.
And they were there, you know, they're present. So I know that's not the same for every single household, but for sure that had a significant impact on me being where I am today.
Great. And then the next one is, because we were talking about, you know, Garden City and your work ethic and all that there, practices and all that. What was your relationship like with Coach Phil Penner, and how intense were those 2 to 3 hour practices?
We had a great relationship. So my brother, he played varsity basketball for Garden City Collegiate, and he's 4 years older than me. And when I was, you know, previously at Leland North, when I was in grade 7, I would go and practice with them sometimes. Yeah. You know, I'd practice with the Garden City varsity team, and that's how I kind of introduced myself to Phil and to the team. And I knew a lot of my brother's friends who played on the team, so they all knew me. And that was his first introduction to me, and he was like, yo, this kid is good, like, you know, I was competing, I was actually playing well against players who are 4 or 5 years older than me. So that's where our relationship grew. So he, you know, he coached me for 4 years, but in reality he knew me since I was 13, you know, 12-13 years old. So our relationship was great on the court, off the court. He gave me a lot of advice, you know, just about work ethic, being a leader, you know, being a role model, because people were going to look up to me, you know, being a younger player. You know, I was playing varsity when I was in grade 9, so he really, you know, I would say he's had the biggest impact on me.
Yeah, because to play varsity as like a freshman, like that's some pretty big stuff right there, like, and you got to be ready to, you know, face a whole bunch of challenges, and the road there isn't just straight, it's like a lot of ups and downs
for sure,
especially as a freshman. So it's crazy to see you playing varsity straight from grade 9, and it's awesome.
Yeah, for sure.
The next question I want to ask, because, you know, I'm from Garden City too, and like I'm currently attending, what does it mean to be a Garden City Fighting Gopher?
Obviously it means a lot. We had a lot of accomplishments, you know, once we were there, and I just feel like it's a very rich culture as far as sports goes, not just basketball, but all sports. And I believe the Garden City community does a good job of having the alumni come back and give back, whether that's, you know, attending a practice or games or coaching. So from that standpoint, I'm like very proud, you know. And also, you know, before we won the provincial championships and before we became this kind of household name, you know, there was obviously people who paved the way before us. So I'm very, you know, I honor those people that came before us, and we just had that underdog mentality. So when I think of Garden City, I think, okay, you know, we don't have the centers who are 6'11 and 6'10 and 6'8.
We have shorter
players,
teams,
you know, who are just tough minded, you know, grit and grind kind of guys.
Exactly.
And
guys who have a lot of heart.
Exactly.
And much like that.
That kind of mentality. So that's always stuck with me, you know, and I'll always be a Garden City Gopher. You know, we are Gophers. It is kind of funny, but at the end of the day, we won, and, you know, that's what matters the most.
Great. And the last question about Garden City is, what are some lessons you've learned during your time at Garden City?
Oh, that's a good question. That's a really good question. I mean, like any, I think like any kid or, you know, in high school, is you learn, you know, which path do I take? You know, do I stray away and do, you know, things I shouldn't be doing and skip in class and things like that? Or do I just have good work ethic? You know, I feel like obviously Phil and the basketball program was amazing and they did a great job. But I also feel like, you know, the principals that I had, the teachers that I've had, when I see them to this day, we still have relationships where we can talk about, oh, you're still playing and I remember you 15 years ago, you were always a nice kid and this and that. I honestly feel like the teachers and the staff there were very, you know, they're good people. You know, they wanted to see individuals grow. So the biggest lesson, I don't know. I would just say like work ethic and being a good person. I would say those two things.
Yeah, because I definitely say like about the staff, like, because I have experience with them. It's like they definitely want to see people succeed. They definitely want to see those who truly work hard, like, succeed there. Like, everyone there, from the guidance counselors, your gym teachers, your principals, your EAs, like, they all want to see you succeed. Like, they're not trying to tear you down, telling you, like, you can't do any of this. Like, no, everyone there at Garden City really wants to see you succeed. So I feel like you're bound to succeed if, like, you have all the support. And, you know, we talk about having a good foundation and all that. So it's like, I feel like Garden City has, like, one of the best foundations. It definitely has, like, a family-type feel, you know, every gym teacher and all that. Very supportive.
For sure.
And that's how I feel, like, while I'm there, because, you know, I currently attend there. But another thing was, like, you're talking about if you should go the other path, because it's tough. Like, in high school, like, this stuff just happens. Like, when I saw it for the first time, it was like, damn, my friend's starting to do this, or, you know, they're starting to do trouble. And it's like, you know, I don't want to be around that, right? Or, like, I don't want to see that, right? So it's, like, important to kind of get, not necessarily get rid of them, but get rid of, like, that, like, you don't want to see that often in your life, and you want to go, like, your own path. And, like, I appreciate you and your journey and all that, because, like, you just stuck to it. Like, I remember my mom was talking about it. It was like, it's awesome to see that you just stuck through this goal of yours, you know, professional basketball player, from, you know, like, 11 to, like, where you are now. Like, it's amazing that you've kept focused, because it's hard to, you know, fall into the wrong side and do all these things and all that. But if you got to be pretty strong to, you know, stay on that path, because it's really tough, especially in high school, and there's many variables and things that change.
Of course.
And then the next question I want to ask, heading back to your pro career, is what steps did you take to find success as a professional athlete?
I feel like I get asked that question a lot. I feel like I said, like, for instance, me going to University of Calgary was like a professional decision.
Yeah.
It was like, I'm going here so I can learn from these players and this team and this coach and this organization to help me become a professional. So by my second, third, fourth, you know, basically my whole time there, I was treating myself as a professional. You know, I was, the way I would approach training sessions and the way I would approach my work and film sessions and things like that, I was looking at myself like, you're a pro. You know, I put that in my head. I'm like, yo, you're a pro. You need to do X, Y, Z to get to become a pro. So when I became a professional, I wouldn't say much of that changed. You know, I had that foundation was already set. So I'm like, let me just see if this is going to translate to a professional level. And I believe it did. The only difference, you know, is, well, there's a lot of differences between being a professional. It's like, okay, well, now what do I do outside of that? You know, once I, you know, you have your practice, you might have one practice in the morning and a practice in the evening, but you got 7 hours in between.
Yeah.
And I don't have any school, I don't have any papers. So it's like, okay, now what do I do with my time? Am I still professional if I'm walking around town the whole day and then I get back to practice and I'm tired?
Yeah.
Maybe or maybe not, you know? So you have to obviously live your life, you know, and visit things. And I did a lot of that, but I just feel like I had that foundation set from, you know, University of Calgary, and I just carried it with me as a professional.
That's great. And we talk about, you know, holding the higher standard. Why is it important to hold yourself to a higher standard?
I mean, that's part of the stay true, be great. You know, that's, you know, I don't know. It's just something I heard a long time ago. I don't remember exactly where it came from. And I know my mom, you know, would always mention, like, you know, be great, you know. And it was just kind of like, why be good? Like, why not be great? You know, like, at everything. Like, why settle for mediocrity? Exactly.
Good,
you know what I mean?
I mean, like, good is good, but, like, good isn't great.
Exactly.
Like, if you strive to be great and, like, do that, like, that's great. And then just wanted to follow up on that, because you were talking about that. What does stay true, be great mean, and what does it mean to you? Like, I know we were just talking about that, but I definitely wanted to let the viewers know about your quote and all that.
Like, stay true, be great to me means, like, first it was, like, stay true, and then I added on be great. Stay true to me is, like, for all the people that know me, like, I'm very down to earth, very honest person, mm-hmm. very respectful person. You know, I'm not like, I'm not gonna lie or cheat or do things yeah. like that. Like, that's who I am as a person. No, that's a foundation that I have. So to me, stay true is like, always stay true to who I am. Always stay true to those principles, you know? Mm-hmm. If I tell somebody I'm gonna be there at 1 p.m., I will be there at 1 p.m.
Exactly.
You know
exactly.
what I mean? So like, that's how I live my life for everything I do. Obviously, I'm not a robot. I'm not perfect. Yeah. Things happen. But that's how I try to live my life. That way, I can always look in the mirror and be like, okay, like, am I staying true? Or am I being phony? Am I being fake? Am yeah. I being, am I trying to be something that I'm not? Am I lying? Exactly. Am I, and I don't, like, if I do those things, I won't feel good with myself. Mm-hmm. So my thing was always like, yo, just stay true to who you are. Stay true, because I know that who I am and that foundation that I've built as a person is good. You know what I mean? And I want to always honor and respect that. So stay true in school, stay true as a son, stay true as a husband, stay true as a brother, stay true as a friend. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Stay true as a student. You know what I mean? Like, because otherwise you're cheating yourself, you know? Exactly. Like, if I get a D on a paper, but I only study for 2 hours throughout the week, I'm not staying true.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? That's yeah. how I looked at it. I was like, bro, you're not staying true. Like, don't be mad that you got a D plus if you only put
the work. Exactly.
You only put 2 hours in, right? So that's the stay true portion. And like we kind of mentioned before, be great is like, okay, let me stay true, but let me also challenge myself to be great at everything I do. You know, we only live once, you know yeah. what I mean? Like, I only get to do this thing one time. So why not try to be great? Because when you're great, it feels good and you can impact other people. Mm-hmm. And I feel good about myself, opposed to like, okay, I'm just going to do the bare minimum or I'm going to do the most.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that's how those two things came together for me.
Great. Yeah. That quote or motto, like, I've lived by that like the last like few years. And yeah, just like you're talking about, like, reminds me every day. It's like, hey, stay true to who you are, mm-hmm. you know? I'm a person who has a disability, so I like to stay true by, you know, volunteering my time with kids who have disabilities, mm-hmm. spend time with that. And then be great is just, again, holding on, like, I don't mean to toot my horn or anything, but just like holding mm-hmm. myself to a higher standard and just retain excellence. Like, that's
for sure.
That's what I try to do mm-hmm. most of my all my days,
mm-hmm.
like living by that quote. Now back to another question. How important is it as an athlete, especially as a professional athlete, to take care of your body in terms of exercise and nutrition? Because I know you have been working with Sherwin and AP Baller and even other places in the world. Like, how important is it to, you know, take care of your body and like exercise and nutrition?
That's a good question. I think for me, that's something that I've learned over my career. You know, once I was younger, I had so much energy. I would just practice for 3-4 hours. Sometimes I'd be outside all day, run, jump, eat whatever, and nothing would happen.
Yeah.
And, you know, as you get older, you know, you have some injuries and knickknacks and things like that. And it's kind of like, at the end of the day, my body is my profession, mm-hmm. like, period, point blank, period. Other people are dentists, other people are doctors, lawyers, whatever, construction workers. Everybody's different.
Yeah.
But for me, like, my body is how I make my money. You know,
exactly,
that's how I feed myself and my family. So what I put into my body has to be good. You know, the food, obviously you have to live, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, have burger or whatever here or there. You yeah. know, I still believe in that, but I'm very strict with the things that I put into my body, with the rest and the stretch and the water and all that stuff. Cause like, the better I feel, the better I'm going to be able to perform. The yeah. better I'm able to perform, the more awards and exactly. the more opportunities professionally that will come. So all of those things kind of work together. And I think it's trial and error. You know, I think for me, it's something that I had to really learn, you know, as my professional career moved forward. You know, like I said, back when I was in GC, I used to train crazy, sometimes 2-3 times a day, you know, mm-hmm. in the summer times, literally like work out in the morning, get back home, have lunch, go do yoga, and then come back at night to shoot. And it's like, I can't put forth that kind of wear and tear on my body anymore, yeah. you know, because I've played for, this will be my 8th professional season. I've played so many minutes that it's almost like less is more now, you yeah. know? So I have to be smarter with the yeah. way I train, smarter
exactly. like
with
we were
that
talking
eat
about
and sleep. Exactly.
Last word, it was like, work smarter,
mm-hmm.
not like harder. Cause it's like, yeah, like as you're getting older and you know, you're like, you're saying your body does make the money, right? So it's like, you got to take care of it.
Exactly.
One great thing that my mom told me before, it was like, I don't know if she was calling J.R. Smith or like if she just said it, but it was like, you want to treat your body like a sports car, right? It's mm-hmm. like, you want to put, say you have like a nice Ferrari or whatever, right? You want to put like the most premium gas in there.
For
you
sure.
don't want to use like the cheapest gas
exactly.
like, just because it's there, right? You want to fuel yourself with like good things. So it's mm-hmm. like, say like training, like you're working out and all that, but also like in terms of like nutrition, like you want to have lots of healthy foods, lots of greens, exactly. But also like it's important too to live, right? Like, for you sure. Don't just want to be like a robot and just be perfect.
Exactly.
Like, if you want to go out to your friends, like for like wig night or something like that, like by all means, like don't be so focused. Like, you gotta go do it. Like, you gotta live your life.
For sure.
And then, okay, so a basketball question I want to ask. What made you fall in love with the sport of basketball?
I don't know. That's what made me fall in love. Well, I played a lot of sports when I was younger. I played basketball, played soccer. I did tennis. I did swimming. I did track. Did badminton. You know, I played everything. Yeah. You know, like, I was just that active kid.
Yeah.
And basketball, I don't know. Like, it was just a deep passion. You know, obviously, when I was younger, watching Michael Jordan and Allen Iverson and, you know, like those kinds, Chris Paul, those kind of players. Yeah. And I was seeing people who were similar to my size doing like magnificent things. You know, I was like, I want to be able to do that too. And I think for me, one of the biggest things was just like being able to go outside. You know, I used to play outside all the time and just be outside for like an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours with a ball. And just shoot. And it was almost like therapeutic for me. Yeah. You know, it's just like, I feel so free. This is fun. It's a hobby. I feel like I'm getting better at something. I feel like I'm creating good values, like discipline and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So I think the fact that I could be outside, you know, with other friends and play, but also go somewhere myself and be like, hey, this is my time. And like genuinely feel like rejuvenated after was a big thing for me.
That's great. And then another question is, this is kind of like about your career and all that, because you've been around the world, you've been in different stages of basketball, played at different levels. What are some of the differences between Northern America, basketball in Northern America and basketball in Europe? And how is the game different?
That's a good question too. I would say like growing up, you know, North American basketball is just more athletic, more faster, more flashy, whereas European basketball is just very, very, very tactical.
Yeah.
And very, very physical. I would say that's the biggest difference that I noticed between even my transition from like University of Calgary to being a professional was like the skill level, you know, is similar. You know what I mean? Like, guys can shoot, guys can dribble.
Yeah.
But in Europe, it's like guys set screens, guys roll to the basket, guys have high IQs, they make the right pass, they head fake before they pass.
Yeah.
You know, they take their time. They're not in a rush. Like, and it's very physical. So I would say European game is very, very physical. And it's, and in certain countries, not every country is different, but a lot of countries, it's very, very tactical. Mm-hmm. You know, when I was in Spain, I would say that's one of the countries where I learned the most, just as far as like, no, like head fake first, make a bounce pass, like the smallest details, but they actually make a difference, you know, as far as being a disciplined, sound IQ basketball player. In North American basketball, I would say, is just more athletic, talent, one-on-one, a little bit more. And now I think they're starting to merge the two.
Yeah.
You know, but I would say those are the biggest differences.
Yeah, like European basketball definitely is like more tactical and like technical too. But it's like, I remember Luka Doncic, he was saying basketball in Europe, way harder than where I'm at right now, like in the NBA. And like, everyone's like, what the hell? Like, this is the best thing in the world, right?
For sure.
Then you look at it and it's like, yeah, there's some truth to it. It's like, like you were saying, like dudes have high IQ, they roll the rim, like they set hard screens. Like, it's not all just like the flashy moves and all the jazz and all that. Like, it's a lot of tactical game.
And it's a different game too, you know, like there's different rules, you know, in FIBA, there's no 3 seconds defensively. So you can have your center inside the paint the entire possession.
I actually never knew that. So you could have your center just camping
there's
there
no
the whole
three
time.
There's no defensive three in the key.
Wow.
There's no, so a lot of the rules are different. So imagine if you just had like Shaquille O'Neal or Dwight Howard just posted up in the key every possession. Now getting to the rim to finish is much harder, right? So the floor has become smaller. Whereas in the NBA, it's more about entertainment. So they want that big to get out of the paint so players can dunk and stuff, right? So it's a different, it's literally a different game.
And then another question with that is, what are some of the differences between high school basketball and university basketball? And then university basketball and professional basketball for you, let's say.
For me, I would just say, okay, I think this is a good comparison. High school basketball, you're the best player on your team. You know, for the, like, if I'm going from high school to university, I can only speak for myself. You know, you're the best player. Everybody's individually best player. Once you get to university, most of the guys there were the best player on their high school team too. So now it's like, okay, you know, there's some teams in high school, you know, there's starters, there's role players, there's the level of competition is not always the same. Now the 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 are all, you know, all-star type players from high school. So the level of competition is higher. So I would say that was the biggest difference between high school and university. It's just like everybody is good now. You know, it's not just three really good players on a team. Everybody is good.
Yeah.
And then from university to
the pros,
the pros is exactly that. They're pros.
Yeah.
You know, university, we have class, we have friends, we have food court,
these guys do it for a job.
This is our job, right? So
yeah,
you know, guys are not only good, but like they're dedicated, you know, they're going every day to put up hundreds of shots and work on their craft. So you're working with professionals and you see like the level of seriousness also, like this is how people feed their families, you know. So there's a difference between people who play university for fun or for the experience, and there's a difference between people who are doing this like, this is how I feed myself, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And pro ball is like no joke. Like I remember, because you're a coach at the Danny Green basketball camp, right? And that's where I met you. But I remember the Raptors had just won the championship. Yeah. And I'm not dissing Danny Green, like he's one of my heroes, but lots of people were pointing the finger at Danny Green. Oh, we almost sold that game, right? You know, calling him all types of trash. Comes to Winnipeg and, you know, there's like a bunch of the best high school basketball players and he's playing one-on-one with these guys. He's taking one drill, he's jabbing, one drill pull-up, all net. Mm-hmm. And it's like, that's like an NBA starter, right? So it's like crazy. It's like a bench player on the NBA. Let's say like Peyton Pritchard, for example, like he goes and plays against like regular 9-to-5 workers in like the Pro-Am or something like that in Seattle. He drops 94 points. So it's like pro basketball, when you're doing this for a living, like, it's no joke.
Oh yeah,
like,
for sure.
They will cook anybody. For like sure. It doesn't matter if they're at the end of the bench starting, like
not
pro
matter,
ball is
man.
No joke.
There's only 400 spots. In the NBA, I believe there's only 400 spots. So out of the entire world, there's only 400 spots. And then the rest of those guys, like myself, who play overseas, there's a whole lot of guys overseas who are super talented that could be in the NBA too, but they just didn't have the opportunity to make it there.
That one is crazy. Then, okay, next question is, what are three qualities you think every basketball player or athlete should have? Because I know, I actually didn't know up until like a few days ago, but it was like, I didn't know you also used to play soccer too. You're like pretty good at it. So as an athlete or as a basketball player, what are three qualities do you think that every athlete or player should have?
Work ethic. So I've already gone over that and explained what my work ethic looks like. I would say work ethic. I would say discipline, you know, have work ethic and also be disciplined. And then I would say coachability. You got to be able to be coached. You got to be able to learn. You can't be, I don't care how good you are, you can always learn.
Yeah.
You can always learn more or achieve more or become a better player or a better teammate. So I would say your work ethic has to be very, very good. Then you have to be disciplined so you can do that work ethic and, you know outside of your profession or outside of the sport, getting your rest, your food, those kind of things.
Yeah.
And then coachability. You got to be able to learn. A coach has to be able to yell at you and you can't take that the wrong way.
Yeah.
You know, you got to know that he's coming from a good place trying to make you better. I'd say those three things are key for any athlete that has aspirations to go far.
Yeah. Cause it's also important that like you're open to learning too. Like you don't want to just think like, oh, I'm the guy, like, this person can't tell me this. Like, F is he talking about? Like, you got to be open. And especially like you're talking about, it's like, you got to see their point of view. Like, they're trying to help you. Like,
for
they're
sure.
not trying to tear you down, even though they may be yelling at you or whatever. Like, they're trying to help you and they know you're great and they know you could succeed. So they're just pushing you there.
For
so
sure.
That's what I feel is a big one, is just being open to learn. The next question I wanted to ask, it's kind of like about your mindset, because you played in a lot of big games. What's your mindset going into those big games, such as like Pack the Jack, Provincial Finals, FIBA World Cup games, KPAC Finals, Danish Championships? Like, what's your mindset like going in those big games with a lot of people watching?
My mindset is this PG-18. It's like kill.
Yeah.
You know, it's now. I mean, now that's just kill. Like, you just have to dominate, you know. Like, that's my mindset. You know, I want to be the best player on the floor, period. You know, obviously it's not going to happen every game, but that's my aspiration, is I want to be the best player on the floor at the end of whatever that looks like, whether that means I have to pass the ball a lot today and get a lot of assists, whether I have to rebound or play defense or just manage my team and make the right decisions with the ball in my hands, or if I have to score a lot of points, or I just have to be locked into the point where maybe I didn't have a good game the whole game, but the last 2 minutes I hit a big shot or I make the right play.
Yeah.
So I would just say looking to dominate and kill, and just also knowing how to keep a level head, not getting too high before the game, getting too anxious, too excited. I want my teammates to see me be like, okay, he's calm, he's collect, he's collected, he's cool. You know what I mean? Like, he's ready.
And then the next question is kind of going back to your early stage in your career. Who were some of your mentors in your early stage of your career?
Mentors, I definitely say my older brother, because he was, you know, 4 years older than me, and we used to play outside one-on-one. He used to give me a lot of pointers. I used to play with him and his friends all the time.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, Phil Penner has had a big, big impact on my basketball career, Steve Tackey. And then I would just say players that I watched a lot, definitely watched a lot of Magic Johnson early on in my career. That's, you know, for those who don't know, that's one of the reasons I wore number 32.
Yeah.
With him, he was a big inspiration for me. And Chris Paul has always been like my favorite player, because I always felt like, you know, I remember I started watching when he was at Wake Forest as a freshman.
Mm-hmm.
And by his sophomore year, I was like, man, this is like my favorite player. He's not even NBA, but like my favorite player, just because he's short like me. He's not like a speed demon. He's not a freak athlete, but he gets the job done. And at a very, very high level, I'm like, well, I don't consider myself a speed demon. I don't consider myself a freak athlete, but I want to be able to still dominate at that height. So I looked at him a lot. Allen Iverson, obviously, Michael Jordan, but I'd say Chris Paul, Allen Iverson, and then later on Kobe, just his mindset.
Yeah.
You know, rest in peace, of course.
Yeah.
But his just his mindset and his approach. So I would say those three to four players had a big impact.
And no, I before like me too was like Chris Paul, like that was the reason why I wore number 3, not Jordan Poole or nothing like that, but Chris Paul growing up was like my favorite player, not because just on the stuff he did on the court and how he played and how he was able to take over games and how he's like a general, but how he conducts himself off the court, you know, very professional. You know, he's been the president of the National Basketball Players Association. You know, I'm sure we've seen the State Farm ads, but like,
yeah, for sure.
He's such a great guy off the court. I mean, he's a really great model to look role model to look up to.
For sure.
And then the next question is, what is your fondest memory of basketball?
My fondest memory of basketball? These ones are hard for me because I've just had so many experiences, you know, winning provincial championships, winning a championship this past year in Denmark, my first professional season, making nationals, you know, when we were in university, going to tournaments in the States when I used to play for the Vipers and Mayhem, and when I was a kid, Maples. I remember when I was like 5 or 6, that's when I started playing, and we would always have these, at the end of the year, it was like, it's like Maples Community Basketball, from what I remember, University of Winnipeg. And you would have these kind of like games, skill games at the end of the season, and players from each team would have to go. And you'd have to like maybe do a certain pass or a certain dribble. And at the end, I would always have a few awards and I would always be competing with somebody else. I always remember that when I was young, but I have so many because I've had so many different experiences.
Exactly,
you know?
Playing for that long, like not a lot. And the last one for, again, the rapid fire question, just about a book. So in our last workout, we discussed about books and one book you'd recommend. I brought that particular book today, Ask and It Is Given. Can you explain why you enjoyed the book Ask and It Is Given?
Why I enjoyed it?
Like, if you could remember.
Yeah, for sure. I feel like, you know, like I've talked about my work ethic and how hard I work and my foundation, my family, and you know, I always want to become more successful. And I just said to myself, well, you know what, like at this stage of the game, I'm a professional now, like everybody else has put the work in to get here. What's gonna set me apart? What's gonna make me different? Because everybody can shoot, pass, dribble, they're athletic, you know, a lot of people have skill. And I was like, I think it's gonna be my mindset. And you know, I heard Big Sean talking about this, and he has a lot of books that he recommends, and that's where I got it from, this and a few others. And I just wanted to kind of have a different approach, you know, to not just the basketball, but to life.
Exactly. Yeah.
And Ask and It's Given really opened my mind to, you know, meditation, journaling, you know, being careful what you say with your mouth. You know, the things that you say, a lot of times they become manifested, you know, the things even that you think, you know. So if you're always thinking negatively, ah, I'm never going to get this, I'm never going to get this, I can't do this, then it's going to become your reality. Opposed to if you change that mindset, doesn't mean guaranteed you're going to have it right away, but it's going to open up doors for you to make those things possible. So it just really put me in a mindset of like, okay, basketball, there's skill, there's all that, but like I want my mindset to be sharp. And I also want my mindset off the court to be sharp. And that was probably the most powerful book I've read, as far as just like visualizing, meditating, you know, writing things down, going back over them. And like I said, being careful what you say, things like that.
So I found the book the exact same way you did, through Big Sean. And he has a list of books that he recommends. And this one stood out after I read it. And after I read this book, like this entire journal over here was just filled with just stuff from that book. Like just things that you could write down and things you could practice. Affirmations and stuff like that. It's like, that's what filled my notebook. It's a really great book, and there's lots of great lessons. So moving on to the last few questions, like these are all rapid fire. So these are going to be more quicker questions. We have time still, so we could, you could take time. First question I want to ask is, Allen Iverson or CP3, who influenced you more?
Oh, that's hard. I would say early on, Allen Iverson, for sure. When I was younger, I had the answer band. I wanted cornrows. I had cornrows, headband. Like, AI was my guy. When I was like, let's say 5 through, I don't know, 10, 12. But once I saw CP at Wake Forest, I don't know exactly how old I was from there. Like, I tried to model my game after him, like, from then on out, from high school on out to my professional career. Like, he's always been, and like you said, you know, he's a stand-up guy off the court too. You don't really see him getting in trouble with the law or anything like that. So I was like, man, this is somebody who basketball wise like I respect. You know, he doesn't have like crazy, well, that's another story, I was gonna say crazy tattoos and things like that, but that's here nor there. That's not a big deal now. You know, I look at that differently, but you know, I want it to be like that too, you know. Like, I want it to be clean, I want to be clean cut, and just the way he plays. So I would say he had the biggest influence by far. Okay.
The next question is, which one have you felt the most nervous for? K-Pac finals, provincial finals, Pac the Jack, FIBA World Cup games, or the Danish championship? If you ever felt nervous for...
Probably the first... Honestly, probably my first provincial final. Like, after I won that, like... Well, not I. Obviously, our team won it. You know, after we won that, Garden City won that, like... It just gave me so much more confidence and affirmation that all the hard work is paying off. And I just had a lot more confidence moving forward. So like from then, I wouldn't say I'm somebody that gets that nervous, honestly.
Yeah.
Like it happens sometimes. Yes. You know, I'm not perfect, but for the most part, I wouldn't say I get too nervous for games. You know, I'm ready to go. But first provincial was definitely, it was nervous because it was new.
Okay. Next question is, favorite basketball shoe at the moment?
Favorite basketball shoe at the moment?
At the moment.
This is on record. I'll look into the camera when I say this. I wore Kyrie 5s for like 3-4 years. Great shoe.
Yeah.
And recently I just tried the KD 14 this year, and I swear by that shoe.
Yeah.
So I recommend anybody who hasn't tried it, go get you a pair. I've never wore KDs ever before at any time. I've been playing professionally for 7 years. I've been playing since I was 5 years old, but I think that's a great shoe.
Yeah.
Great cushion, very comfortable, snug. So I like it.
Because I remember before, like when I first met you, it was like all just Kyries, Kyries every year. It was like a new team card Kyrie. But then just recently I see you like Sherwin and all that. It's like 2-3 pairs of like the KD 14s. Yeah. I'm like, wow, I'm like, I think you must have converted in the KD side. Yeah.
He got me. I converted.
Great. The next question is, top 5 pregame songs to get you pumped up.
Top 5.
Wow. 5 or 3, but it doesn't really matter.
Montana 300, Envy Me, Chicago rapper. My boy DJ Richardson put me on. He used to play at Illinois. Played, you know, that's where Darren Williams and D Brown came from. Great teammate, great dude. He put me on that, Chicago rapper. That's probably one of my tops. I really like Blue Notes right now by Meek Mill.
That's a classic. That is a classic. Shout out Gerard.
Yeah.
I know you're watching that.
After his last album.
Meek Mill?
Yeah, the last album.
Expensive Pain?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Blue Notes on that one. I didn't like it at first. I was hating, but I think it's nice. Those are the two that come to my mind right away. Success, Jay-Z and Nas.
Well, that's
old school song. Yeah. My first song, Jay-Z, old school song. Those are ones that are like always on my playlist if I had to think of some. And then mixture of everything else after that. Okay. But I got a lot of my pregame stuff. I got a lot of Nipsey, Nipsey Hussle, a lot of Meek Mill, a lot of old school Jay-Z, some old school 50 Cent, and some Young Jeezy, some old school Young Jeezy.
Young Jeezy, shout out Young Jeezy, he's one of the best.
So I like the old stuff a little bit more than the new stuff these days. So
yeah, I definitely feel the same. Like a lot of Jay-Z, Nas, especially Young Jeezy. Young Jeezy gets you motivated, but yeah, I feel the same way. And last question is, you know, when you think about your whole journey, your whole career, your favorite city you've lived in during your pro basketball career?
Can't do that. I can't do that. So like, I get asked this all the time, and I would just say each city has provided a different experience for me. I would just say I'll put my top three out there and I'll say why. And this is no disrespect to the other places I played in. I loved everywhere I've played. Portugal, just because it's my first professional experience. So that was my dream since I was like 12 and I realized it. So that was a big moment for me just being there. It was very tropical. The food was amazing. The weather was great. The people were so friendly, multicultural. You're seeing black, white, Hispanic, Spanish, Brazilian. You're seeing a lot of people that look like you, different cultures. So Portugal for that reason. And also my family came to visit me. So my parents came to visit me. So that was a good experience. My brother came to visit me. Then I would say Spain. And the backstory to Spain, I'll do this as quick as I can, is like I started learning Spanish when I was in university my last year with a friend of mine, just because we always had a desire to learn Spanish. And my dad, he lived in Madrid for 2 years when he was 19. He moved from Nigeria to Madrid all on his own. So he worked there for 2 years and I always wanted to go to Spain for that reason. And I eventually got a contract in Spain, which is a dream come true. And my dad and my mom, they came and visited me and my brother. And we went back to where my dad lived like 30, 40 years ago. It's like apartment that block that he lived in and it was still there. And we were just there together. And just like the look on his face was like, man, like he was going down memory lane. So that's a moment that I can never, you know what I mean, recreate.
Yeah.
A special moment for us, for me and my family. And lastly, I'll say France, just because that's where I met my wife. You know, we just got married recently about a month or two ago. And I mean, I met my wife there and, you know, we did a lot of traveling, you know, to different places, Marseille, Paris, Dijon,
Dubai,
you know, a lot of places at Dubai. Like that's when I started to travel a lot is when I was in France. And that was the first time I worked so hard to become a professional basketball player, but you also have to be able to enjoy, you know, the process as well. And that was the first time I kind of let my guard down and allowed me to visit and travel and obviously eventually meet my wife. So those three places have a special place in my heart.
That's great. Okay, we're going to make this quick over here. What's your advice to anybody wanting to follow your path? And at the end of that, is there anything else you'd want to address or any last words?
Anybody want to follow my path? I would just say create your own vision of what you want. Like I always say, like, put your mind to something, like decide what do you want to do, whatever it is. You know, if you want to be a doctor, dentist, basketball player, nurse, it could be anything. You know, just like put your mind to it, be like, decide, you know, this is where my stay true, be great comes in. Like, decide what you want to do, write that down, then put forth the effort into it. Like, the work ethic needs to be there. Surround yourself with good people who are going to keep you straight and keep you in line to help you achieve those goals. That would be my advice. Like those three things. Decide what you want to do, period, point blank, period. Set a goal. I'll say this right now, and this is not good for kids. Some parents are not going to like me for this, but I'll be honest, I didn't have a plan B.
Yeah.
Like I had a plan A, and my plan A was to be a professional basketball player, and I'm here now. Thank God, and I've been healthy and hopefully that can continue. But I always had plan A in my mind. I was like, I'm going to give everything I can to plan A. And if it doesn't work, then fine. But I felt like if I had a plan A and a plan B, then my plan B is already taken away from plan A.
Yeah.
So to me, at a young age, it just didn't make sense. I'm like, you see how focused I am on this. I'm going to focus on that.
Yeah.
So I would just put those three things together. And last words, shout out to the podcast, man. This was a great conversation. This was a great conversation. You asked a lot of good questions and you're young, but you know, I can tell you're dedicated. You know what I mean? You put a lot of work in to make this happen and you know, always very respectful, and I appreciate that, especially for, you know, some of your age, you know, that goes a long way. And I wish you the best with the podcast, and just keep doing it, man. This is definitely a passion for you, I can tell, and you got a bright future in it.
Great. Thank you. That means so much, especially coming from you, you know, my biggest role model, and it's just amazing to have you here and just talk with you for about like near like an hour. So this is really a dream come true, and this is a goal I've had in mind since like, well, like the last like two summers, and then I finally get a job. So it's like, okay, I got the money now. Let's do it.
Yeah, for sure.
And I'm just going to conclude the show, and then I'm going to do a bit of shout outs after. So that concludes the first episode of the Danny Digital Show. And for my shout outs, I'd like to shout out at Garden City, Madame No. I know you're proud of me watching this. She also taught you too, I remember.
She did,
so
she
shout
did.
Out Madame No. Shout out Mr. Peterson. Shout out Bubbly and the new Watermelon Bubbly in stores now. Shout out my mom for always believing me and supporting me. Shout out Clothing Bakery for the vintage tees. I heard it increases strength by 300%. And then shout out my barber, Cuts by Kean, for always keeping me fresh. Thank you guys all for making this possible. Thank you, Derek Benjamin, for engineering it. Thank you, Vanessa Peters. And thank you to all the good people at Privateer Recording. I'm out.